disrupted manufacturing and deliveries, the uncertainty surrounding the euro, particularly with concerns related to Greece and others, and the question of how Europe's austerity measures will impact the U.S. economy. After all, Europe is our largest trading partner. 26 out of the largest 100 cities had job gains in all of the last four quarters, which were primarily in high-tech markets such as Boston, San Jose, Portland, or also in the energy sector markets such as Dallas, Houston, Oklahoma City, and Pittsburgh. The southern metro areas that specialize in government and transportation and warehousing continue to suffer, including Atlanta and markets like Memphis. Overall business, investment, and exports, particularly agricultural commodities, held up, but led to a disappointing amount of growth. And uncertainty about government regulations is keeping consumer corporate confidence weak. Dissatisfaction with Congress continues. Wall Street Journal recently had a series that you might have seen called the Generation Jobless, with staggering figures. The number of adult children, including one of my own that's living with their parents, has increased from 4.7 million in 2007 to 5.9 million in 2011. And that appears to be continuing to increase.
That's
only one of those was mine. I'm hoping the other three don't add to those statistics, but I'm not certain that it won't happen. 59% are of 18 to 39 year olds receive support from their parents. 4-year in-state tuition has risen to 70K, out of state up to 120, and private to 160. The aging baby boomers are consuming less. As many as 2 billion people will join the middle class in the next 20 years, mostly in Asia, Brazil, India, and China, which has a tremendous impact on agriculture and lifestyle products. Healthcare is the best performing sector right now, with $2.6 trillion in expenditures annually just in our country alone. Our aging population will continue to need additional care and products that are still to be developed. Healthcare spending in the U.S. accounts for a larger share of GDP than any other country.
Highest vacancy rate in the metro area, that's despite what went on toward the end of the year with UBS staying essentially for about 5 more years due to additional government incentives. We will revisit that in about 2016 and 2017 to see if they indeed stay or pull back and come back to Manhattan. For the most part, the idea is that they will, but we'll have to kind of wait and see. The desire from their brokers, from the traders, is to be in Manhattan. Westchester County, then Nassau, Suffolk, Attleboro's. Manhattan, the second best vacancy rate on the list. First and foremost, Jersey City, Hudson County, the lowest vacancy rate in the metro area, which is the good news. Right along the riverfront, it's a small submarket, though, 16 million square feet of Class A space, and no new construction underway for Jersey City right now. That's a good thing, at least temporarily. Average asking rents. I just like this slide because it's fascinating to see how much higher the asking rents are in Manhattan versus all the other markets, which are all bunched together essentially in the metro area. Go ahead after that. And on the office sales, transaction volume, and the cap rates, this is through November as far as 2011 goes. And 2011 will end up being better than 2009 and 2010 combined. A lot of this activity, not surprising, Manhattan, although Jersey City, Hudson County has been number two on the list. There have been a couple of high-profile deals that closed toward the end of the year in Jersey City, which crunched that number up a little bit. I started my career in 1995 working for a competing firm in Lower Manhattan on Wall Street, and I tend to be very bullish on Lower Manhattan. I see a lot of positives going forward. The biggest positive, obviously, there's a lot of space coming back to the market. One and four World Trade Center, new construction. You also have Merrill B of A giving up 3 million square feet over the World Financial Center and one and four, or two and four World Financial Center. A ton of space coming back to the market. But it's trophy space, it's great space, it's green space. You have great landlords in Silverstein and Brookfield, obviously, over the World Trade Center. And I think they're going to be incredibly popular because I think they're coming back to the market, or they're coming on the market at the perfect time. Generally, when you build a building in New York, new buildings in New York take 36 months, 48 months to be completed from when you break ground. It's just no way around that in this city. And generally, tenants or landlords or owners break ground when the market is red hot. By the time they open, the market has cooled down tremendously, and you sit on those buildings for 2 or 3 years, or either you lease them at below market. These buildings were started
in a down market, and they're probably going to be opening in a very strong market. The other issue is that there will be no competition in Midtown for new green space at that time. So between all the new construction in Lower Manhattan, between the much more mixed-use 24/7 market, between the great transportation that's going on down there right now, between the infrastructure all the way around, I think it's going to be huge. You've seen that in Condé Nast going down there. You've seen it in Chadbourne Park, probably leasing a few floors at One World Trade Center, a Midtown tenant. So, and we see a lot of that. When tenants looking for space, they are very curious about Lower Manhattan. And the discount in rents is still 30 to 50%. That's what it costs in Midtown.